Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Peter Goddard, Director of the Institute for Advanced Study, and it's my pleasure to welcome you here to this talk. Our speaker this evening is well known to many of us. George Dyson is both a child of the Institute and a former director's visitor at the Institute. He is, of course, the son of Freeman Dyson, Professor Emeritus in the School of Natural Sciences. George grew up at the Institute, attended Princeton High School, launched his first kayak, which he'd built himself, into the Delaware and Raritan Canal near the Institute's swinging bridge. As the son of a mathematical logician and also one of the world's great theoretical physicists, it might have been expected that George would have followed in his parents' footsteps. But his chosen route in life has been along a path all of his own. He has said that one important assumption that he took from his upbringing was that in the essential spirit of this institute, however he made or barely made his living, he would retain the freedom to engage in intellectual inquiry without constraint. George left home at 16 and moved to British Columbia, where he supported himself by working along the fringes of the waterfront and where he developed both theoretical and practical knowledge of the kayak, the subject of his first book. With his subsequent books, George has become a leading historian of technology, writing lucid accounts of the history and future of artificial intelligence and of Project Orion, a program for space travel propelled by nuclear explosions in which Freeman was intimately involved. George began writing his most recent book, just published, Turing's Cathedral, The Origins of the Digital Universe, when he was a director's visitor at the Institute in 2002 to 2003. It tells the history of the early electronic computer, focusing in particular on John von Neumann's pioneering computer project here at the Institute. In the course of his research, plowing through the Institute archives, he's become one of the leading experts on the history of the Institute, the person I turn to when I need advice. More than this, he played a very active role in gathering and preserving material related to the electronic computer project just in time, including contacting many of the project's survivors. The Institute owes George an immense debt for documenting the history of the project, for collecting this material, and for interpreting the place of the project in the creation of the digital universe as we know it today. The book has received a great deal of media attention already and has been widely praised, as one reviewer put it, an amazing tale brilliantly deciphered. Now, George, who's got so far through his life without being encumbered with either a high school diploma or a college degree, has finally been cornered by academia in the shape of the University of Victoria in British Columbia, who are making him an honorary Doctor of Letters this December. I'm told by my spies that when the invitation arrived, with characteristic modesty, he assumed it was misdirected and intended for his father. After the talk, or in the coming days, you may be interested to view the exhibition of materials from our archives related to the electronic computer project, which is now on view in the ground floor corridor of Ford Hall. George's title this evening is The First 5 Kilobytes Are the Hardest, Alan Turing, John von Neumann, and the Origins of the Digital Universe at the IAS. George.
Thank you. I have a lot of thanks to give, but first of all, thanks to Peter, who was one of the references for this fact that I was am going to be awarded an honorary degree. I kept waiting for Princeton High School to give me an honorary high school diploma, and they won't. But thanks to Peter, I will become an honorary doctor of the University of Victoria, which is a tremendous honor. And I have to thank Peter's predecessor, Philip Griffiths, who it was exactly 10 years ago, it was March 2002, that Federal Express delivered an envelope, and I opened it up, and it was an invitation to come here as director's visitor, completely, absolutely unexpected, out of the blue. I mean, I was stunned. And of course I said yes, and changed everything for a year to come here with my daughter, who was in eighth grade at the time, and it was a fantastic year. And the sort of most important thing I think I can say is that the people I'm going to tell you about, I mean, you're going to see a little bit of the story of this small group of people who was here at the Institute right after the war, 1945 to 1956, who conceived, designed, built with their bare hands from putting in the first electrical outlets to, you couldn't buy lumber after the war without a certificate, so they bought, quote, firewood and built their first workbenches out of firewood. And that small group of people got the machine finished, got it running, wrote the software, debugged the software, and solved large fundamental problems that still puzzle us today in less time than it took me to write about it. And and that, you know, that's a sobering thought. And I also, so I have to thank all the people at the Institute who helped me during that year and in the years since, and let me keep my email account and keep working on this for such a great length of time until I felt I had the story in a sort of finished, publishable form, including my publishers who were not here tonight, because this was the one evening that I convinced them to stay away and let's just tell the story to the people who helped make it happen and not sell books. But that's what I've been doing for the last 2 weeks is going around selling books. And it's a very interesting 14 lectures and 23 interviews in just under 3 weeks. One of the interviews was with NPR, supposed to be at 2 p.m. this afternoon. And I barely got here because I missed my train. So the interview had to be done on the packed New Jersey Transit train coming from Penn Station. And the guy, the interviewer from NPR is on point, keeps asking about why did they need this computer to design hydrogen bombs? And I start trying to explain, and then I realize everybody in the car is looking at me. somebody's going to call the transit police and stop the train. And you're all going to be here, and there's nobody, you know, where's George? So I've been on this tour, and the interesting thing is that the tour, and nobody arranged this, but this tour they put me on followed the path that led to this project happening. So my first stop was Louisville, Kentucky, and the publisher apologized. Oh, we're so sorry. You know, most authors don't want to go to Louisville, Kentucky, but they have such a great library, and we hope you understand it's important to go there. No, I'd love to go to Louisville because that's where the Flexners came from. That's where Abraham Flexner teaching his daughter Jean to read. They were from Louisville. Abraham's father was a peddler selling goods from his back who finally, with his first $4, he bought a horse. And Abraham and Simon Flexner were as you probably know, were the people who made this, you know, had the idea for this institute. That was Flexner's school in Louisville. And when I got to my hotel, I thought, well, you know, tomorrow I'm going to really go around. And I had the addresses of where some of Flexner's various schools were. I'm going to try and find some evidence of Flexner. And then I was coming in on a late flight, and I went to get something to eat. And I turned around, and this was the mural on the side of my hotel. And that play, Mrs. Wiggs and the Cabbage Patch, was a very successful play written by Flexner's wife, Ann Flexner, that gave them the financial resources to leave Louisville and come here and do this. So there it was. And it became a screenplay that then became a W.C. Fields film. And that was one of the last of Flexner's schools was in this house that still exists. So that's the predecessor of Fald Hall. Then they sent me to Philadelphia. And that's where the land came from. That's why the Institute is here, because this land was acquired essentially as a legal fee for William Penn, who was also trained in law and had sort of executed the bankruptcy of some people who had acquired. It's very complicated, but the land ended up in the hands of William Penn and William Olden and five other partners. And so the ownership of this land actually only changed hands twice since William Penn, who was a great radical. He got in all sorts of trouble in England. And in this trial, not only was Penn sentenced to jail, but the entire jury that refused to convict him was sent to jail. And so the Institute has a real, its basis lies in this sort of questioning of British authority. And also in Philadelphia, Philadelphia was home of the ENIAC, which was the ancestor of the Institute Computer. The Institute Computer didn't come out of thin air. It looks to us like suddenly computing appeared at the end of World War II. Actually, computing, modern digital computing, appeared during World War II, but it was in secret because there were two big problems, the code breaking on the British side and the nuclear weapons design on our side were both secret projects. After World War II, those sort of opened up. So the ENIAC, in the most, there's huge dispute over what happens in the branches and trunks of that tree, but nobody disputes, or actually some people do dispute, it's disputed heavily, that the ENIAC was at the base of all this, and where the ENIAC came from is another question, and I try and avoid that, those arguments. But here at the Institute, things really began with this report that was produced by Arthur Burks and Herman Goldstein working in the only room that was vacant in Fald Hall in 1946. Everything was full after the war. We forget that the League of Nations had been kicked out of Geneva, one of their departments. And that entire department was something like a couple dozen people were all stuffed into the third and fourth floor of Fald Hall. And everybody shared offices. Most of the visitors worked in the library. But Arthur Burks and Herman Goldstein were put into the one room that was vacant, which was the annex to Kurt Gödel's office, because Kurt Gödel was distinguished enough to have a secretary, but he didn't want one. And that room was empty, and nobody wanted to disturb Professor Gödel. So they wrote this report in there. I'm interested in all the little details. Who typed that report? And it turns out the person who typed that report was Akravo Emanuelides, who was 16 years old, a high school student in Philadelphia, hired. She went to her guidance counselor wanting to go to college, and the guidance counselor said, no, it's impossible for you to go to college, but we can find you a job at the University of Pennsylvania on this strange project that needs secretaries. So she hired on as Herman Goldstein's secretary on the ENIAC at age 16 in 1945, and came here. She did such a good job, Goldstein brought her here in 1946. So she typed those reports. Her first day of work was June 6th. And she's still alive and well because she was so young then. So one of the first lectures I gave the week before last was at the Computer History Museum in Mountain View, right next to Google's headquarters. And she came to be in the audience, and they did not want to put her on stage because this was all being filmed for KQED, and they thought she might ramble on. She's in her 80s. But towards the end, I insisted she come on stage, and she stole the show. She's just told the stories of, as she should, you should have her back and speak here because she, you know, she was one of the, since Otley Selberg is gone, she's one of the last people left who was hired under Adelot before Oppenheimer. So she was here when Oppenheimer arrived and just remembers it like it was yesterday. And then I went to Philadelphia just a couple days ago, and Washington, D.C., the Smithsonian gave a talk there, which is where the machine built here actually belongs to the Smithsonian. So it belongs to the people of the United States, and it's not on display. It's in one of their storage basements. But part of my mission, I hope, if I can draw enough attention to this, they'll put it back on display where it belongs. So that's how this book happened, being invited here. So it's sort of 10 years later, I'm finally delivering what everybody expected I would do in that year. Well, George is coming here for a year to write the book. It took an incredibly long time. And if you're an author, there's three things you're afraid of hearing from your publisher or from a publisher. The first is the letters of rejection saying, you know, we love your idea. It'll be a great book, but it's not for us, and I'm sorry we can't publish it. You get lots of those letters. And then if you get the contract, then a couple years later, I got lots of these letters, you get the letter saying, you know, where's the manuscript? We are going to cancel your contract. And that's bad. But then the thing that really is terrifying, you eventually get a letter, if you write the book, then you get an email letter saying, we've designed a cover and we think you will like it. And in this case, the publisher sent the mock-up of this cover, and it was so brilliant, the idea of punching the digital holes in the paper that the book is, you know, it just was, and then putting Turing, because Turing is not the lead character in this book. Von Neumann is the lead character, but it was Turing's laid the foundation that this whole cathedral of modern computation was built upon, and he deserves the title credit. So that just expressed it perfectly, that underneath all this digital layers, there's Turing. So I was happy. And the epigraph, the opening, where it should say, you know, thanks to my mom and dad, or thanks to my wife who waited, helped me patiently. The credit is to Leibniz, because it was Leibniz in the 17th century who invented this whole world, who invented the logic, and we credit him with that, but we forget that in an unpublished manuscript of Leibniz, he actually proposed a digital computer that you could build a calculating machine using black and white marbles running down tracks, and he wrote the algorithms for how simply by shifting these tracks right and left, you could perform all the functions of arithmetic. And if you could do those, as you know, Turing and all the other sort of recursive function people told us later, you can do everything. And whether you do it with marbles or with electrons running down wires through gates, it's the same thing. So really what von Neumann did here was to realize Leibniz's dream. And Leibniz also said that this was not made for those who sell oil or sardines. It was not simply for selling ads on Google. It was for something else. So the other remarkable thing is that after you finish a book, the question becomes illustrations. And they say, well, send what you think. And I sent 82 illustrations, and 81 of them were included in the book. The only one that wasn't was that title page of the first report. But in small black and white. All I'm going to do now is go through in the exact sequence that they are in this photo section, the pictures, but with color and with a little more information behind them. So the first picture is, this is not a picture of the digital universe, this is the digital universe. In 1953, the machine here was running, there were a few other machines running, but in 1953, it's an easy number to remember. In the entire planet Earth, there were 53 kilobytes of this high-speed random access memory. Not memory that was on tape, but memory that could any location could be accessed in a sort of speed of light time. And the way that memory was stored was as spots of electric charge on the phosphorescent face of these oscilloscope tubes that were in the building where the fitness center is now. So you could see the bits, and those were not representations of bits that were somewhere else. Those were the actual bits doing the computation. So it's a complete switch from the way now the bits are in my computer and they're being displayed on the screen. The computation actually was visible. And this is a piece of paper saved by Julian Bigelow, who was von Neumann's, the engineer who made this. You know, von Neumann had the ideas and Bigelow made them real in hardware, and it says, orders, let a word 40 binary digits be two orders, each order equals command and address. And now we take that absolutely for granted, that all computation is done by giving a command and then the numerical address at which that command takes effect. But at the beginning, somebody had to sort of write that on a stone tablet and give it to the engineers. And that, I think that could be the piece of paper, because they don't say bit, it says BD, binary digit. And it was later that John Tukey got tired of saying binary digit all the time and said, let's change it to bit. A very important page from the logbooks that are all here, just on the other side of the wall here, marvelously saved by the archivists here. So we have a record of what happened day by day as this project got going. So stop at 18:08. That was the first night, March 3rd, 1953, when Nils Barrichelli, the viral geneticist from Norway shows up and starts trying to run evolving strings of self-replicating code within this 5 kilobyte universe. And he gets the machine after the Los Alamos people leave till the early morning, and now the Los Alamos people have come back, and it's back over to the bomb calculations, which were not supposed to be spoken about. Alan Turing at age 5, just a brilliant young child, who his mother says he had a wooden toy soldier who lost its arm, and he went and planted it in the garden so that the arm would regrow. And John von Neumann at age 7. So these are very similar minds, just obsessed with mathematics from the earliest childhood. And the modern historians have divided into partisanship that I think is unwarranted, sort of arguing the von Neumann side versus the Turing side. And no, von Neumann just stole Turing's ideas and never gave Turing credit. And then another side that says, no, von Neumann didn't use Turing's ideas at all. So I decided to look. And again, in the social science library here, you have that expanding shelving where you have to turn the wheels to open. So if you open those shelves up, no one goes there because everything's on the internet now. But they have the proceedings of the London Mathematical Society, which is the volume in which Turing's great 1936 paper on universal computation was published. And if you open those shelves up, all those volumes are just mint. They're in perfectly good condition, except the volume with Turing's paper. It's completely disintegrated from being consulted so often. And we don't know. Maybe it was consulted later by Stephen Wolfram's group or something. But I don't think so. I think then the engineers I spoke with surviving all said, yes, when they arrived here, von Neumann said, read this paper. This is what we are trying to do. That's the cryptanalytic machine that was built in England during the war in deep secret, the Colossus, which had 1,500 vacuum tubes used. So the problem was to decrypt German communications between the German high command and the U-boat fleet. And those were being digitally encrypted. But the British did not know the state of the German machine which had encrypted them. So they very cleverly built this vacuum tube machine that, like a Turing machine, that can imitate another Turing machine by changing its configuration. It could rapidly change configuration and imitate a whole bunch of suspected configurations of the original. So suddenly, Turing's ideas that had been absolutely abstract in 1936 became very real in hardware and in many ways affected the outcome of the war. Turing in 1946 getting on a bus. Alan Turing was born 100 years ago this year, so we're really celebrating his centenary. And he died tragically at age 41, just when he was becoming interested in biology, computation was starting to flourish. It was a real tragedy. Von Neumann in 1952, at the dedication of this, so this is June 19th, so that anniversary is coming up. In June 2012, it'll be the anniversary of that. The machine was actually running before that, but it was publicly dedicated then. Why are we here? I just am puzzled by all questions. So, you know, why did this happen in Princeton? Or in fact, why is Princeton here in the first place? So Princeton's here because this is the headwaters of the Raritan estuary. So New York is down here. And this is the headwaters of the Delaware, where Philadelphia is. And as far as you can get in a boat is New Brunswick, on what's now New Brunswick here, and what was then called Delaware Falls and is now called Trenton. And there was an Indian trail between the two that became eventually a wagon road. And then a man named Henry Greenland built a tavern right in the middle. So halfway you could stop for a beer and spend the night or change your horses when people, if you wanted to go quickly, you could actually get fresh horses and keep going. And that became the town of Princeton. And then there was another group of people led by William Penn, who were sort of devout Quakers, and they were trying to get away from Philadelphia and New York. They felt that the influences of the city were a little too corrupting, looking for a quieter place, and they selected Stony Brook, just on the other side of the Institute Woods, and built the meeting house that's still there, that's now the Friends School. So you had these two different groups, and in a very real way, the tavern became the town of Princeton and Princeton University, and the meeting house became the Institute for Advanced Study. So, and so this is, you know, we are on the land that was settled by that group, and they would hopefully be happy with the result. So Fald Hall was built in 1939. You probably know how important it was as a refuge for the people fleeing the disaster in Europe. Oswald Veblen is really the lead character behind putting that together and having the clout to get these people. You know, they got Stan Ulam here for $300. They got Gödel out of Austria for $1,200. They really, I think part of the Bambergers were, the Bamberger business was started by buying distressed merchandise at bargain prices, and they did that in spades, including, that's how they got von Neumann. At that time, and how many, you know, university, but the sad truth was that it was very difficult, if not impossible, to hire a Jewish professor at Princeton University. So they could not, Veblen desperately wanted von Neumann, but he couldn't hire a Hungarian Jew as a full professor. So he had the brilliant idea, he hired half of two Hungarians, and that created no problem. He hired von Neumann at halftime and Eugene Wigner at halftime. And nobody objected to giving a Hungarian a halftime position. That was okay. And they both came, and they both stayed. So, and Oswald Veblen also hired Norbert Wiener when he, you know, during World War I, who contributed a lot to this project here, because he was closely talking with von Neumann about computation, and Abraham Flexner from Louisville, who advocated for the usefulness of useless knowledge. And that's why we're here. And the Bambergers, who made it all possible and should be remembered. It's the meeting of the first mathematics faculty. Oswald Veblen, who always was out in the woods cutting firewood, he's always wearing clothes that you could go out in the woods in. Johnny von Neumann and Oscar Morgenstern, who were creating the theory of games, and Einstein and Gödel. And Gödel gets not enough credit, I think, for his contributions to this whole cathedral, in a way, because the architecture of computing, the way we do it, is based on this idea of numerical addressing of strings of code, and that by manipulating the numerical addresses, you are actually manipulating the underlying code. And if you look at Gödel's great proof of 1931, that's how he does it. And I'm simplifying things tremendously, but I mean, he labels the strings that are formulas with strings that are numbers, and creates a mapping between the two, and the really important results are from that. And I'm convinced that that was in the back of von Neumann's mind when he sort of created this whole world. So that's von Neumann at age 11. And at age 12, at a Austro-Hungarian artillery emplacement, and Johnny's the kid sitting on the barrel of the gun. So he's very comfortable. He liked weapons, and he liked military power, and at the wedding of his cousin Lily. So these amazing Hungarians, Wigner, Teller, Szilard, Erdős, I mean, they all came out of this world of Budapest between World War I and World War II. And what brought my story to life, really, it was sort of a dull, maybe some people think still a dull story, but when, thanks to Marina von Neumann, who's one of your trustees, Johnny's daughter, she said to me after I'd been here, you know, you should come to Ann Arbor, there's a filing cabinet you might want to look at in our basement. It's always a filing cabinet next to the water heater, rusty old filing cabinet. And in the bottom drawer, she didn't want to look, these are letters, love letters to her stepmother. There was all the correspondence between Johnny and Clary from 1937 to when he died, documenting there's no pictures of that here, but all the letters in the original envelopes, carefully preserved with the postmarks, handwritten, and that was my story. I mean, really what brought it to life was Clary's view of coming to Princeton, coming to America, driving across the country to Los Alamos for the first time, and that's Johnny's identity card from the University of Berlin, where he resigned in protest when he saw what was happening. and did his best to help get as many other people out. And the quote that goes with this picture is that Johnny could tell by looking at a pearl necklace on a woman's neck exactly how he could tell you exactly how many pearls there were. I mean, he had that kind of mind that could see numbers in a different way. That's Princeton in the 1930s. So everybody there is Hungarian, except this is Percy Robertson, who was teaching quantum physics to Alan Turing at the time. We forget that Alan Turing was here. The other people who wonder the relation between Turing and von Neumann. Well, Alan Turing was here in Princeton for 2 years, and Amelia Wigner standing up. She was from Madison, Wisconsin, but all the rest of them are transplanted Hungarians. So they sort of had a little Budapest going on here. John von Neumann, Richard Feynman, and Stan Ulam, who came out of Poland, rescued his brother, lost the entire rest of his family at Los Alamos in 1949. A photo taken by Nick Metropolis, who was also here at the Institute quite frequently. In fact, Akervo says that she was always sending letters for Nick Metropolis to Post Office Box 1663, Santa Fe, and she thought he had a girlfriend there, but that was the Los Alamos address. So they succeeded, beyond expectations in the atomic bomb. It was a tremendous success. So they had great clout with the government. The government was willing to fund whatever von Neumann wanted to do next, and computation was really next. That's sort of why it happened so quickly and why it happened here. But ENIAC was publicized. It was so big you worked inside the machine. That's Hermann Goldstein here in the uniform, who actually was still in the Army when he came to the Institute and was one of the two people that von Neumann gave permanent membership to Goldstein and Julian Bigelow. So von Neumann saw that the ENIAC was only the first step and played a role, and there's a tremendous controversy. Did he write this entire document? Who knows? His name was the only name on the title page, which I think was very unfair. We don't really understand why, but whoever's ideas they were, he somehow put them together into a document that laid out the architecture of the modern computer with a memory and an input and output. And another reason this happened here in Princeton was that Vladimir Zvorikin was here, actually living he was living on Battle Road at that time, and then he was allowed to buy Riefler's house on Battle Road Circle, or no, Professor Lowe's house. And he was the leader of the RCA electronic labs. He was a Russian refugee who escaped from Russia in 1919 through the Arctic and sort of brought color television to America and thought computing might be the next big thing. And so the first meetings of the Institute Computer Project were actually not held at the Institute. They were held at RCA in Zvorikin's office. And then RCA sort of backed off. I don't know if we really want to invest in, we've wasted so much money on television already. Do we want to go into computers? So they didn't. I think it was a huge, they could have been IBM. But if you look at the fifth person on that list, that's John Tukey from Bell Labs and the university, who finally gets tired of saying binary digit over and over again, says, well, let's just call it a bit. And then we have bits. And the administrative assistant here was Bernetta Miller, who was sort of a director's assistant at a time when there weren't the staff that you have now. There's much fewer. So she kind of did everything, executed all the contracts, did the hard paperwork to keep this place running, kept people out of Fald Hall who weren't supposed to be there. And she was the fifth woman in the United States to get her pilot's license. And she's here in College Park, Maryland, demonstrating the Blériot monoplane, which the French Blériot company had an American subdivision. They were trying to sell this to the US Army, who at that time found it unthinkable that you could, in combat, fly an airplane that only had one wing, because all their airplanes had two wings. And so this was, and their idea was, well, let's get a woman to fly it. That will convince them it's safe. and then her, very tragically, her eyesight, she started to lose her eyesight and couldn't fly and ended up working for Frank Adelot at one of his schools before he came here. So the institute had all these people, and that's Ackervaux, who was at my talk in San Francisco last week. So she typed. That's a verityper. It's the ancestor of what became the Selectric, where you can, to type mathematical papers, you can put different symbols in this disk. And Norm Thompson, who was here doing meteorological codes, if you look up your 5-day forecast for next week, you're still running his codes, just with a lot more input data and a lot more processing. Herman Goldstein and Gerald Estrin, who went from here to the Weizmann Institute in Israel, built the first machine in Israel. So the machine that was built here was replicated in all these other places in the world. RCA was supposed to contribute the memory. This was the Selectron, was a 4,000-bit pure digital memory tube that was like the dinosaur with feathers. But it's the reason that this architecture that was developed here at the Institute, when microchips and solid state and core memory came along, the architecture didn't have to be changed because it had been sort of expecting this all along. The architecture was designed for this plug-in Selectron memory, just like you plug in your USB stick into your computer. It was exactly the same idea. And even though only one computer was ever built with these tubes, that did very, very well. They by the time they became commercially available, they were replaced by the magnetic core memory. So the people here got frustrated, no memory. Everything else is ready to go. The sponsors are saying, well, you know, where's this machine? So they go back to Manchester, England, to Turing's group, and adopt their memory. The group in Manchester had developed cathode ray tube memory. So this is Tom Kilburn and Frederick C. Williams, who deserve credit, and they got credit. The people here, they call their memory the Williams II, after Williams. There was no question of who deserved credit for it. That's Jim Pomeroy with one of those tubes. So they used, von Neumann's principle was only to use available commercial parts. So these were war surplus oscilloscope tubes you could buy. They needed to be perfectly flaw-free. It didn't matter for an oscilloscope. So they made a deal with the manufacturer in New Jersey to send all the tubes they produced came to the Institute, and they selected the good ones and sent the others back. And all these documents, of course, are here. Most of them are from, they're either from Julian Bigelow's basement or from the archives here. So that's the difference. You know, what we now think, well, you don't have to worry about the difference between a 0 and 1. Then you did. So you have this fuzzy distinction. And in 0.7 microseconds, you're trying to tell the difference. So these are sort of time scales nobody had really worked in before. The machine itself should be in the Museum of Modern Art. It was a true work of genius. And that was due to Julian Bigelow, who was an engineer. So it was built like a V40 diesel engine with memory cylinders and overhead valves bringing the numbers in and out. And that's why it worked so well. The design was compact. He was aware that the speed of light mattered. You had to keep this thing small for it to be fast. And the wiring was all three-dimensional. We still do most of our computing in two-dimensional computers. It's all laid out flat. And that computer was way, way, way ahead by actually doing the wiring in a three-dimensional way. So that's the way it was and the way it really still is. Bigelow did when it finally went to the Smithsonian, he personally, you know, made sure all the important stuff was included and saved. It's Julian, Herman Goldstein, Robert Oppenheimer, who was director at the time, and von Neumann, and all the large numbers of engineers who helped, and a lot of the women with names some known and unknown did most of the coding and programming, including Hedy Selberg. And where to put all these people? There was no place to live in Princeton. So Julian Bigelow, being a problem-solving engineer, he went up to Mineville, New York, 300 miles north in the Adirondacks, where there'd been an iron mine built during the war to iron for weapons, and then it was vacant. And he purchased these buildings at auction, and that became the housing project. He cut them in half. They were moved down here by rail. And the Princetonians objected strongly. You know, you turn Princeton into a trailer park. And that's where people lived, and that's, of course, where my mother and father met, both as as visitors. Visitors were put in those barracks, and people loved it. There's, I mean, it's of course still true today. It was one of the best things about the Institute was living right there. That's the ancestor of your hard disk, which that was a magnetic wire input-output drive, and they were able to get this very primitive thing. They got 90,000 bits per second input-output on that drive. So that's how they would write the code to that drive and then input that into the core of the computer and then output. So it was exactly the way your hard disk works. Everything done with vacuum tubes to get sort of binary behavior of vacuum tubes was not easy. This is the very first shift register that I believe is still in Julian Bigelow's basement on Horner Street if it hasn't been thrown out. He saved that kind of thing. So somebody had to make the first shift register, and this is fundamental to the way all computers work today, that the bits, they don't shift directly across. They shift up into a temporary register, and only when the temporary register says, okay, all the bits are here and they all match, then you bring them down. So you can never lose a bit. And a lot of the physical work was done by high school students working part-time and wire men who just soldered all the connections very carefully. That's the wiring diagram for the shift register that was finally selected. You can see it's shift register number 7. They tried 6 other versions before deciding on number 7. Jim Pomerine and Julian Bigelow and Goldstein at the machine. Willis Ware, who was the last, as far as I know, and I think this is pretty decisive, he's the only one of the original engineers still alive. He's 91 and mentally in great shape, but physically declining. But he sent me a message last week. He got this book and just said it was an emotional experience opening this book and seeing these people he hadn't seen for 60 years. He went to RAND, so RAND also propagated this sort of the gospel, according to von Neumann, out to the world. That's the first flow diagram I was able to find for a Monte Carlo problem coded by Clary, by Johnny's second wife. And Monte Carlo was pretty much invented or credited to Stan Ulam, who again was brought here and then moved to Harvard and Madison. He's winning at poker at Los Alamos. And there's no better example than Monte Carlo of the usefulness of useless knowledge, because they were having tremendous problems with these neutron diffusion calculations that were very hard to do analytically. And Ulam was working terribly hard on that with Nick Metropoulos. And then he got a near fatal case of encephalitis and was put in the hospital. Some people said he was never the same afterwards. And the doctors told him to stop thinking. The way he tried to stop thinking was he started playing solitaire. He said, well, that'll be okay, I'll just play solitaire. And then the more he played solitaire, he started to visualize that these games of solitaire were like these neutron diffusion problems, and that you could simply follow the sequence of probabilities of a series of games, and you would get an approximation of the, and Monte Carlo happened. And so while trying to not think, he solved, it's probably true that Monte Carlo has solved more real problems in the real world than any other algorithm ever conceived. I mean, it's a very profound thing. And Clary just happened to be in the right place at the right time. Johnny went off during the war to Britain for reasons we don't really know. We weren't supposed to know then, and we still don't know now. Why did he go to England for 6 months? But he did. And Clary was left alone here in Princeton, very bored and unhappy, and took a job at the Office of Population Research, which was run under the Woodrow Wilson School. And she worked on statistics of human populations, doing modeling populations, what would happen after the war as populations started recovering. And that turned out to be exactly the kind of mathematics you needed to solve these criticality problems for fission bombs. Because it really is a population. What happens to the population of neutrons? Johnny bought a new Cadillac every year. This is on their honeymoon to Key West, in Key West. And that's Stan Ulam and Françoise. And Françoise was also one of my most brilliant sources for getting the human side of what really had been going on at the time. She was a French journalist who died just this last year. Nick Metropoulos, his badge photo, So he was here a lot in the early times. They put him in the housing project. And here, a little later, he's playing the first game of chess against the computer at Los Alamos. And they're playing on a 6x6 board to make it simpler, with no bishops. And they called it anti-clerical chess. And Johnny is, this is the Grand Canyon in the 1940s. They love the West. Just von Neumann, Turing did not like America. He wanted to go back to England, but von Neumann loved America. And the day he got off the boat, he changed his name to Johnny. I'm Johnny, and here I am. And someday it'll probably be a film or something. But so here he is, there at the Grand Canyon. His mule is facing backwards. While the other, and he's wearing a suit. And that's Clary. And all these family photos are thanks to Marina and Nicholas von Neumann, who also just died this last year, who still was the last of the three von Neumann brothers, was a patent lawyer in Philadelphia. The Ulam family with Johnny, that's Francoise lying down, and Claire, who still lives in New Mexico. They called it Los Ulamos, because the Ulams were so hospitable. That's a picture that puzzles me. It's by George Gamow of the actors in the hydrogen bomb drama in the early 50s. So that's Stalin with the bomb and Robert Oppenheimer looking like a saint. And Stan Ulam spitting into a spittoon and Edward Teller in the middle and George Gamow pulling the tail of a cat. And I think there's some significance to what they're doing related to the different approaches to trying to get a thermonuclear reaction to self-sustained, but I don't understand it. Nobody's been able to explain it to me. Von Neumann and von Braun, the rocket pioneer at the Redstone Arsenal. And another thread in this whole story comes from Lewis Fry Richardson, who's often left out. So in World War II in England, he is spending a lot of time, he's in the Friends Ambulance Unit, working really hard during battles, but nothing to do between battles. And so between battles, he develops this numerical model of the weather by running difference equations between adjacent cells. And he has the data for one day, and he spends the entire war just trying to model this one day. And the results are completely wrong. And von Neumann strongly believed that Richardson, in principle, was right, and that if you had enough, if you essentially put filters in the equations to filter out noise, you would, and that's what worked. That's what Norm Thompson and Joseph Smagorinsky and the other people here got working. And Lewis Fry Richardson also, he answered the artificial intelligence question, sort of at what point does a machine become intelligent? And they're all intelligent, some have more intelligence than others. So this is a non-deterministic circuit, which is something Turing believed in, actually, that only non-deterministic machines could become intelligent. So this is a non-deterministic circuit illustrating a mind having a will but capable of only two ideas. That's the first expedition down to, they had developed these meteorological codes, but the machine here was still delayed, so they got impatient, and they went down and ran them on the ENIAC, and this is the day at which they're all so happy. They finally got a 24-hour forecast in less than 24 hours. and we're just about at the end. When you look at what was worked on here, okay, so they had 5 kilobytes. They had a 32 by 32 by 40-bit matrix. Each tube was a 32 by 32 array, and they had 40 of them. So that's this sort of three-dimensional memory matrix. If you put in 5 bits on one side, 5 bits on the other, it's 10 bits, you get back a string of 40 bits. And that's why we live in this world today, because as soon as they got that thing running, you put in 10 bits for an address and 10 bits for an instruction, you get 40 bits back. And then with those 40 bits, you have 2 pairs of instructions. And that's why the world exploded. And every year, you know, you can buy twice as much memory for half the price, because we're just trying to fill it up. So here at the Institute, in that 5 kilobytes, they worked on 5 fundamental problems. They worked on nuclear explosions. So the scale in the middle, from 10 to the minus 8th to 10 to the 17th, is seconds, the scale in seconds of time. So the nuclear explosions, everything's over in billionths of a second. And then they worked a lot. Von Neumann was very interested in this problem of shock waves, of nonlinear behavior of shock waves. And that's what happens in the next second few seconds. And of course, the military was, that's weapons effect. And the meteorologists came in, a large group, or significant group of meteorologists were here, led by Jewel Charney, who worked on meteorology, which is sort of in the middle. That's a period of hours and days. If it's months, then you start talking about climate, but really weather. And then Nils Baricelli showed up doing these biological evolution simulations, which are trying to simulate what happens over thousands, millions of years in biology. And Martin Schwarzschild came from the university, who was modeling the evolution of stars. And von Neumann loved that, because all these other things, you had nothing to really compare it to. You couldn't go out and, well, they did, actually. They did go out and test bombs and see how the models were working. But with astronomy, you could look up in the sky and see these different kinds of stars at different stages of their lives. And that then was taken over by John Bacall, who continued that tradition. So that range of scale is 26 orders of magnitude in time that they covered in 5 kilobytes. And when you look at where we are, to finish this picture, I put in things that we can perceive, like the blink of an eye is the shortest time we can really humanly perceive, and the longest is maybe your whole entire lifetime of 90 years. And exactly in the middle is a working day of 8 hours. And that's a puzzle I don't understand. I mean, it's a question I really don't know. Is that just because we are in the middle, we see both directions, or why do we happen to, our attention span happens to be in the middle of the perceivable universe? But what the computer did, and which is exactly what von Neumann wanted to do, was vastly expand our, as a scientific instrument, just our range of perception of phenomena in the world. And the fact that they did, those are all 5 problems that still are very difficult computationally, yet they made such progress, you know, in less time than it took me to write the story about it. So von Neumann was, in a way, covering his bets. On the one hand, they were designing this machine, the hydrogen bomb, that could destroy all life on Earth, but he also was designing a machine that, within which Baricelli was looking at creating new forms of life. Baricelli, this is his application to come to the IAS. The only that and one other photo that I know survive. And Christine DiBella very kindly came up with this after, just in the last minute, I could put this in the book. So Baricelli thought directly in full binary code. He didn't use any shortcuts, and created these artificial universes and let them run overnight. And then he would lay out. Atle Selberg told me about how, you know, he would come in and he would have all these cards laid out on blueprint paper and be photographing them. And those are, so we here have these fossils that are real fossils from the beginning of the digital universe in a way that don't exist anywhere else. And I think people will be coming here to study this material for a long time. That's Alan Turing in 1951 helping build a computer in England. Julian Bigelow, who would be 100, this year is Alan Turing's anniversary, next year would be Julian Bigelow's. And the very last entry in the logbook, when after von Neumann died, the machine went to Princeton University, who never really got it running, and then they brought in Julian Bigelow to get it running, and he finally gets it running, and then they pull the plug. They kill the project. July 15th, 1958, off 12 o'clock midnight, JHB. And when I came here, thanks to Joan Scott and Adam Ashworth in the School of Social Sciences, are actually the people who brought me here. I'd been here as a child, and then I got a call or a letter from them. We're looking at the social implications of computing. Would you come give a talk? That's how I got here, and I got into the basement to look at these, at that time, unprocessed boxes. And in the bottom of one box that seemed nobody had looked at was a full set of cards and code for one of these artificial universes of Baricelli, with a note that said, there must be something about this code that you haven't explained yet. And that goes directly back to what Alan Turing was trying to do in the first place, that he was not trying to invent computing. He was trying to answer this question of the Entscheidungsproblem, the question mathematically of whether by looking at I'm probably going to garble this up and make it wrong, but by looking at a string of symbols, is there a systematic way to tell whether it is a provable formula or not. And he proved the answer was no in a sort of Gödel-like paradoxical way by showing that you could build a machine that could do anything that any other machine could do, and even that machine that could do anything that any other machine could do could not answer all questions. And one of them is the question of whether by looking at a code you can tell what that code is going to do. And that, to me, is at the essence of what makes the digital universe so interesting, that we are never going to be able to predict systematically what any code will do. You can't make a firewall that makes it completely safe. When I came back here in 2005, I wanted to go look at the room where they had actually started working, which was the next to the boiler room in Fold Hall. It was the only space that the engineer, where the engineers used that firewood to build their first workbenches. And I went down there, and it was at that time the main server room. And the system administrator who showed me around, what is everything? There were 54 megabits per second of optical fiber data going in and out, and there was one entire, supercomputer running 24 hours a day, and its job was to keep out self-replicating strings of code. So in the same place where Baricelli worked so hard to evolve self-replicating codes, we now have a machine whose job is to keep them out of the institute. And that's when I realized how, we really lived in Baricelli's world. And when I saw that note, I knew that was the last sentence of the book, and all I had to do was write the other 431 pages. And that takes us back to the world that Leibniz envisioned at the beginning. He saw that the whole world could be expressed in digital code, and he thought that if we understood this digital universe, we would somehow understand the real universe. And it's, I think, significant that Gödel spent the last years of his life here studying Leibniz's manuscript. He was convinced that Leibniz was onto some deep secrets that had not been fully explored. And the last photo in the book is me in front of Fald Hall and my sister Esther, my sister Katerina, and my mother, Verena Huber, so thanks to all of them, I got to sort of live this story and come back to it in a way that I never dreamed of at the time. And thank you to all the archives here and the other families and people who let me explore this stuff. And very specifically, thanks to the discipline, the academic discipline of history, which is really the only academic field that is, besides astronomy, I think, that is really open to contributions by amateurs. That if I had gone to the physics department and said, I'd like to use the lab for a couple of days, the answer would be no. But as a high school dropout, I found I always was welcomed at archives. If I knew what I wanted to look at, I was given the same access as someone with, three PhDs, and that's a huge credit to to the historians in general and archivists and librarians in particular. Thank you. So. I probably went a little long, but we probably have time for a few questions, and Peter will tell us to stop when it's time to stop, if there are questions or corrections. Yes.
What does your cover say?
In the code?
Yeah.
It means nothing, and when the designer came up with that, then I gave him a few of Baricelli's cards. Photographs and said, well, here, if you want something real, here it is. And then he very kindly called me back and said, is it okay if we move some of these around for sort of artistic purposes? So as far as I know, but I think people will have fun trying to decode it. But okay. Yes. No, that's why I write history, because it doesn't change. I mean, I have a fixed target. If I was trying to write a book about the future of the state of search engines or something, yeah, I'd be a total failure. But by focusing on something that happened 60 years ago, I'm safe. But so it, no, the target really was fixed. So I changed the numbers. Like at the last, when the thing went to final proofs, I put in the numbers for how fast the digital universe is growing now, which are quite astonishing. It was five trillion bits per second, and 2 trillion transistors per second is what how this thing is expanding. Yeah, so. But you're right. It's a very difficult field to keep up with. Yes.
Do you have the idea why the institute dropped the idea of developing computer in 1956 or 7? I don't know.
Well, the person to ask to answer that question is my father, Freeman Dyson, who actually was assigned the job of under Oppenheimer of querying some noted experts in the world on what they should do about the computation project, and particularly what they should do about the essentially what was a school of meteorology. And the answers were quite interesting. The one I remember most was from Sir James Lighthill, who answered, John von Neumann has spent altogether too much time on the field of automatic computation. It's time he revolutionized some other field. I see both sides. I mean, I see on the one hand it was a tragedy to end that group right at a time when it was flourishing. It could have continued without von Neumann. On the other hand, I understand that this was so successful, the administration felt it should be, that it would go on and be done by, essentially IBM took over, but there was a gap in between. So it's a very interesting historical question, but it was sad for the engineers who had, made their homes here and wanted to stay. Most of them did move to industry, and Julian Bigelow stayed. But the documents are there. You can read the sort of arguments both ways. The interesting thing is that several of the trustees were very strongly, they thought meteorology was exactly the kind of problem the Institute should be working on, and that the fact that it had practical implications was not a reason to object to it. So it was an interesting argument.
Read Feynman's autobiography, and I recall that he was here at Princeton, and then he got recruited to Los Alamos,
yes,
the Manhattan Project, and eventually he's put in charge of their computational group. And he said in his autobiography he had to recruit basically high school kids that were good auto mechanics because the computer would break down mechanically so often. And was that related to the work going on? I mean, was it mechanically?
No, that was the work that Feynman did at Los Alamos was the previous generation of computing. Feynman ended up in Los Alamos. They realized, and again, whose idea it was is debated, but somebody had the idea of implosion, and that took a lot more calculation. So they started having to do these large implosion calculations, and they kind of ordered one of everything that IBM made. And they had, through General Groves, they could get kind of emergency procurement status. So these giant crates showed up, but with no documentation and nobody to run them. And they had to find a trained IBM technician who was already in the military and get them transferred. And that was going to take like 6 weeks or something. So Dick Feynman and Nick Metropolis, who came here, spent a lot of time here, they just, okay, we're going to unpack the crates. And they got it all running. And they got it running actually in sort of a different way than IBM would have got it running. And that was, in many ways, the origins of, many of the sort of algorithms they developed for punch cards then became the algorithms that were used later. But
what did you learn that surprised you?
You learned a lot of things that surprised me, and a lot of details. I was, of course, astonished by what Niels Barrichelli had, what he was thinking. It was so. It really was true. He had this vision of, and you have to remember, he had this vision before we knew the structure of DNA. But he had this vision of self-replicating code in biology and ideas that still are not, I think, underappreciated. The really interesting question is how these very complex polynucleotides developed. I mean, DNA is a complicated thing. It's a hugely complicated structure, and that's what gives these You know, creationists, all their ammunition, and how did this thing start? And so his idea, he saw it as a collector society, like social insects, that you had much smaller molecules that started cooperating to go out and bring back amino acids to the nest, sort of thing, like ants. And that as they cooperated more and more, they became more and more cohesive, and eventually you got these very long, complicated molecules. And I think that's a very good way of looking at it. And what he was trying to do in the computer here was run these simulations and see whether that kind of thing would happen. So I think he was, so I was surprised at how he wasn't doing he wasn't trying to make little pictures that look like life. I mean, he was trying to actually see if this sort of process would evolve and at what speed. And then he moved to wherever there was a machine. Every time there was a faster machine, Niels Barrichelli shows up, you know, saying, how about 2 a.m.? Could I use it? So he was a great character. And then if you want a real surprise, and this is, again, a sensitive subject, but von Neumann gets a lot of criticism for having publicly advocated preemptive nuclear attack on the Soviet Union, he wasn't anti-humanitarian, he just was doing, apparently, a really cold calculation that less people would die if we stopped this now before they got the hydrogen bomb. And he had, at Los Alamos, he was working with Klaus Fuchs on a thermonuclear design that at that time they thought would work. So as far as he knew, the Russians had this, it turned out Klaus Fuchs was a spy. So he had good reason to be very afraid of what, and having seen what happened in Hungary, he had tremendous hatred of the Russians and did think this should be stopped before they got if they got the hydrogen bomb, it might be too late. And I thought that was a bluff. I came into this project thinking he was a game theorist, he was a poker player, your opponent has to believe that you are for real. If they think you're bluffing, it doesn't work. But when you read these private letters between him and Clary, it's clear that he was not bluffing, that for a short window of time, he believed that. And then he changed his mind. And he was open about changing his mind. But that was a big disagreement with Oppenheimer. So, and there were other revelations about the Oppenheimer business that surprised me. But I think we've run out of time. And thank you very much.